Ramona Shelburne of ESPN, who had the exit interview, if you will, of Jerry Reinsdorf from The Last Dance here on The Rich Eisen Show. How are you, Ramona?
Good. How are you doing, Rich?
I'm doing better for actually hearing your voice. Thank you. We appreciate for you sitting through those technical difficulties right there. So, was Jerry Reinsdorf eager to talk and set a record straight, Ramona? Did you sense when you spoke to him?
Yeah, he kind of was. Yeah, it was interesting. Like, you know, when I first started to talk to him, like, he had clearly thought about what he wanted to say. It was, you know, he had watched the whole series and he had, you know, kind of had his own thoughts on the matter. And like the first thing that came out of his mouth was like, can there be any doubt that Michael Jordan is the greatest player of all time? Like that was the first thing he wanted to. And he went on quite a while about that. And I think that's what a lot of us sort of felt after watching it. Right. And then, you know, the second part, which I had, you know, I really pressed him on, which was, well, look, why did it have to end? Why did this have to be The Last Dance? You know, I mean, as you watch this, it's obvious that so many of their problems were just internal, that there was a couple of easy solves, which, you know, just fire the general manager. That's the guy who's causing the problems, right? And I think what Reinsdorf's point is like, you know, he pointed out to me that he did try to get him back together at the end. He went to Michael in July, and he said, Michael, don't say anything yet. We're in the middle of a lockout, you know. Let me see if I can get Phil. And he went back to Phil one or two more times and still tried to get him to come back around. But I think by that point it was probably too late. I think, you know, when you play the whole season and it's The Last Dance and you say your goodbyes and like too much blood has been spilled, it was an ugly year. Like it was probably too late for a Hail Mary, right? But were there times earlier that they could have changed things, that they could have changed history? And I think there were, but I don't know if it really would have worked, right? I think that team was getting older. I think, and Jerry's point, which is a good one, is that, you know, a lot of those players were, you know, they didn't really do much after that year. Like Luke Longley went to Phoenix and that didn't go well. And Dennis Rodman played like 35 more games, and Scottie Pippen, you know, he got paid, but he certainly wasn't the same Scottie Pippen after he left Chicago. He had a history of injuries. Steve Kerr, Judd Bushler, those guys moved on. Like they're really, it was going to be hard to keep that team together at that level. And I, you know, I think Reinsdorf's words were like, you know, Michael really had to carry them.
No doubt.
Last year they were gassed. That, you know, look, we just saw how those efforts were against the Pacers and the Utah Jazz. Like, I mean, they barely won that year, and it doesn't mean that they wouldn't have won again, but you know, sometimes you have to like look at something and say like, this was coming to an end.
I remember sitting on the Sports Center set. We were all wondering how the hell is this really going to end? You know, would they really let this thing lapse? Essentially is what the concept is. And I understand that a lot of these guys didn't do very much, although Kerr did win a championship in the next year with the Spurs in the shortened season.
Right.
You know, I understand that they didn't do very much from there on out, but this was all about having one of the greatest rock and roll, if you will, tours in the history of sports.
Yeah.
And running it back just for the mere sense of just you got to see what you have. And part of the reason why it would have been so difficult is obviously Pippen and Phil having their issues with Jerry Krause, who it appeared Reinsdorf let do what he wanted to do. So does Reinsdorf accept any, if you will, responsibility for any of this, do you think?
Not really. I didn't get that from him. You know, like I pressed, right? Like I asked the question a couple of different ways and a couple of different, and part of me is like, I think this is just his style. I think he basically said he went to Jerry and said, knock it off. You know, you guys are winning. Why did you say that 82-0 comment? He went to Phil and said, hey, you and Krause, this is a mismatch. Just let this go. You know, like he kind of wanted them to solve their problem. And, you know, I'm always looking at it from sort of a modern viewpoint, which is like, dude, you're the owner. Like, just choose between them. And I said, why didn't you choose between them? You know, because in this case, like, not making that decision was making a decision, right? Like, sometimes when you know, like, I tend to be a little bit indecisive when I'm, like, scheduling things, right? Like, I'm not sure. Let me see. I'll see in a couple of days. And a lot of it is just, like, it's my own personality, but it's somewhat like my job too. Like something might come up and I have a better idea, like literally the day of, as opposed to, you know, 4 days out. Right. And I think Ryan Surf is the same way. I think he just didn't want to swing the hammer. I think he didn't want to have to choose between them, so he just simply didn't. And he told them to work it out. He tried to help them work it out. He tried to be the middleman, tried to sort of force the issue. He basically told Phil, like, who cares about Kraus? Just go over his head. Come straight to me if you have an issue. Like, why can't you work this, through this, right? And, you know, at some point, when you don't make a decision, the decision is made for you. And that's the story of the Bulls. Now, I look back at this history, and I just watched the 10-parter. I see this from a modern NBA viewpoint. There was a way they could have solved this. And I think so much of the discord came from the situation with Scottie Pippen, mm-hmm. where if you would have just given Pippen an extension a couple years earlier,
right?
Like, you don't even have to do like a 5-year giant contract. You could have done 3 years, you know, 3 years, $15 million a season. He would have been happy. And then that whole thing goes away. Plus, I think it was pretty obvious, like in watching this, that Kraus was trying to turn the team over before they got old, and he couldn't get anything for the stars, right? Like you always sometimes if you wait 1 year too long, now your contracts are big and bloated, and you can't turn over, and it takes 5 years longer to rebuild, right? But you still could have done it if you did a short term extension with Pippen, where you paid him kind of a lot of money,
right?
He still would have been tradable.
What about
this,
though?
They had a trade with Boston that they said no to because they wanted to give a chance that sixth run. But, like, that trade would have been there the next year.
What about this, Ramona? Ramona Shelburne here on the Rich Eisen Show. I mean, as long as we're getting in the DeLorean here, right, and we're going back in time and we set the date to try and change history here, why not? Because to me, one of the more shocking moments of The Last Dance was – Reinsdorf basically recounting him telling Pippen, don't sign this contract, right?
Yeah.
And he's the one that could have at any point in time told Jerry Krause, Jerry, this is ridiculous. We're pissing off somebody who's crucially important to us, and I want to, and I know I'm breaking precedents, and I might be making your job a little bit tougher with other people, but this is Scottie Pippen we're talking about. Extend him. Let's pay him. Let's make sure he's happy. What about doing that when Jordan retires for the first time? And saying, Scotty, Scotty, you know where you're being underpaid, and now we're asking you to take over for Michael friggin' Jordan. How about we go back in the DeLorean and give him the contract extension and make him whole? Then he might be getting off the bench with 1.4 seconds to go, and he's on the floor when Kukoc makes the shot. Then maybe he's not going to wait till the very last second to get surgery before The Last Dance. Maybe he's not going to fall apart. I don't. You know what I'm saying? Like, that would be the moment.
Yeah, and it's interesting because, like, I actually understand Reinsdorf's point, which was, like, you know, he warned him. He said, don't do – and he actually did the same thing with Jordan, by the way. When Jordan did that contract, he said, this is going to end up being a bad deal for you. If you – you know, I know where the NBA is going. I know where revenue is going. You shouldn't do this. But if you sign this, I don't want to hear from you again. And he said, you know, to Michael's credit, he never heard from him. You know, Michael would grouse about it. I mean, I know people covered the team back then, and they said, you know, Michael would say, he was underpaid for a long time. I'm going to get mine. I'm going to get, you know, and he did. Okay. I mean, think about this. The salary cap at that year, 98, Rich, $61.6 million. Michael Jordan made over $30 million. I think he made $33
million
that year. Okay. That's more than half the salary. Oh, sorry. So that was the Bulls' salary, okay? Now 61.6, so he made more than half of what the rest of the team made. The NBA salary cap for the entire team was $26.9 million. So Michael made more as one player than the entire salary cap for most teams, right? Woo! Okay. Now there are those who would say, well, that's kind of like the Warriors this past year. I mean, if they would have kept, you know, Durant and Steph, Draymond, Clay, that could have been a $400 million team. And the Warriors would have paid it because that's what you pay that money to keep a championship team together. But it's a little different, and I don't like to tell billionaires how to spend their money. I don't like to tell anybody, okay? It's a little different when the players are older coming off a lot of injuries, right? It is. It's like you don't feel as nervous investing in Draymond Green and Clay Thompson and Durant. Now, they all got hurt in the finals, okay? So, yeah, you do a little bit. But but they're younger. You still feel like they have more of their prime. I mean, this is more like giving Chris Paul a big contract. You know, this is more like giving somebody who's, like, in that last max contract a big deal. And I know that's that's a little riskier, just based on their ages. And so, your point's right. Like, they could have just extended Pippen and done the right thing by him. But I think there was a sort of principle to it that, you know, they warned him. They said, don't do that. You know, we're not going to renegotiate. I think that just might be how they do business. And,
It's a unique way to do business, right? Ramona. It's a unique way to do business. Yeah. Hey, look, I've got 2 minutes left for the hard out, as you know, in the television business. And it's the only the thorniest issue in the history of the NBA. Forget about The Last Dance. What should we look forward to seeing about the return of action, if at all? Ramona, walk me through what you know.
NBA?
Yes, please.
Yeah, look, I think there's a couple of big meetings that are coming up. They have like a weekly general manager's call. They have a board of governors meeting. I think it's sometime next week. These are all standards. You know, this time everybody's having meetings now, right? All the time. So none of these are like, you know, different than the other meetings. But I think over the next week or two, we're going to see the safety protocols, here are the conditions. They're going to start making some decisions. Are we going to be at home practice sites for some of it? Are we going to be at Disney World? Are we going to be, some combination of both? Like, I think those final, like, here's what it would look like ideas are going to come out, and they're going to kind of be codified and maybe sent to the union and voted on. I think that's what you're going to probably see over the next couple of weeks. Everything's been collectively bargained the whole time. So, like, I don't want to make too much of any one meeting, because they've been meeting and talking the entire time, right? But over the next couple of weeks, I think you're going to start to see some things happen, and we're either going to have a season or we're not. But that's step one, right? As you know, mm-hmm. because it's not just enough to make a plan to come back. You actually have to do it. And then there's going to be setbacks. Like, there's going to be four or five guys who will test positive, and then what do you do?
Exactly.
There's going to be an escalation from shooting in a mostly empty gym with, you know, rebounders who have masks on to, like, full contact NBA basketball again. We're going to see the testing protocols again.
Well, we'll hopefully get to see it. Ramona, thank you for the time. Really appreciate it. You take care. Great interview with Jerry Reinsdorf. That's Ramona Shelburne here on The Rich Eisen Show. Hey, you watched all the way to the end. Thanks for that. Watch more right here.